Roll call, please.
So, hey. So, thank you very much for asking me to present some thoughts as a keynote speech. And I would like to elaborate a little bit on challenges of higher education in addressing, at this very moment, ESD. And being, my background is chemistry, my first degree, chemistry, I teach chemistry for many years, oceanography, and chemistry is very much on structures. And I have a defix English with the trigram. The trigram, which is the most stable structure we know of. Major molecules, but all structures that resist also to earthquakes. So I it's a very useful as I believe also in our conceptual thinking. So the first thing is the very essence of higher education, and that we discussed that a little bit this morning from the universities as custodians of wisdom and sometimes becoming ivory powers. And when ensuring continuity and now providing professional skills for employment, or also ensuring the financial viability of themselves. These are not compatible, all of them 100%. These are different qualities. And one way to see how we can combine these kind of things is the trigram. Because within the trigram, either you put on each facet a notion or a particular quality, and trying to combine sometimes conflicting views, you get into the mass of the trigram, and the mass allows for different combinations. 10, 20, 90% of each component, they are all there. So from the moment you decide that some of the components need to be together, and the trigram is actually a very convenient structure. The same is with learners. And to be, work with others, learn and act, are not independent. These competences all synergize. And following that, we can see also some of the higher education goals from the professional skills for cooperation to personality development, to knowledge, of course, and interaction with the society, citizenship. All of these have been touched upon already this morning. And of course, the higher education, we all know today that needs to move away from strict disciplinary approaches. Many years ago, when this university was established, but till the first quarter of the 20th century, we had, I remember from my university, I don't remember, I know, in the 30s and even 35, before the war, they had introduction for all students with history, philosophy, ethics of science responsibility. Today we are going, we have this sometimes polarization even in the discussions in senates between highly disciplinary specialization for employment and on the other hand, on the other end, the need for personality development as individuals but also as parts of the society, citizens. So let me understand a little bit better the way from disciplines to multidisciplinarity, biogeochemistry, into transdisciplinarity, where we need at least to understand to put the right questions to the other disciplines and know what we can expect from them. And this polarization has to be to the very nature of our beings as humans in our history. From the time that we were one, and there was only one environment with humans part of it, natural only, to very early, from the cave time, when we started developing the Anthropocene, or the anthropogenic environment, with man-made, cultural, and spiritual, putting ourselves against, as a different species, as we are indeed. So this change, although the natural environment remains the same, the Anthropocene is becoming gigantic, more and more. And this affects also our relationship with knowledge and also with the environment, particularly when we are talking about ESD. So, in fact, I said one difference that is there, the other is the pillar approach, even of sustainability. This is the model we have. The pillar still is there. Ecology, environment, society do not meet. They meet only in sustainable development. But we all know we are talking about socioeconomic. So the model, when we had the Thessaloniki conference in 97, we started putting education where we put. We started with environmental education. After the big debate, we have agreed on education for environmental sustainability. It didn't fly. So what is after that? It's abandoning the pillar approach. And we have the non-pillar SD approach, where education was presented as a basis. Of course, this is taking too much on our shoulders. So we changed that. And we put governments as the basis to deliver. And part of the governments, by the way, this is the previous, but if you turn it on the environment facet, we are going back to the environmental education, so we don't betray some of our roots, because we have the environment and the human overstructure of that. So it is just that we are becoming more sophisticated, more understanding the relationships within and with the environment. So if we analyze now, because higher education should elaborate on the tools to obtain sustainable development apart from all the rest. That means governance is analyzed in education, in our case, education for sustainable development, institutions, and the technical fixes, science and technology. So this is what should be in my understanding and what is more or less accepted as the focus of ESD, with the three facets or pillars and the supporting things. And of course ESD, when we remove out environment, we put in culture instead. And this actually fulfills some of the requirements also of the UNESCO and the fourth pillar and all that. Now, you see that I'm playing with the tetrahedra, because the tetrahedra helped me a lot to pass concepts to my students, but also to my colleagues. For example, the Holy Institute approach, because governance, curriculum, infrastructures, and links with society do not stand alone. They mix, and the Holy Institute approach is not the same institute everywhere. One has more strengths on curricula, other in examples, in infrastructure. The overall, what is important is that all universities follow that with different, a recipe is not detailed, but the ingredients are there. So we move to something more on what Daniela said about higher education, construction of global vision. The first one is, as I said, for everything, is the holistic approach, a good starting point. The other is to deal with the big challenge of the anxiety of change. The anxiety of change is between everything is changing, and we all feel it. And on the other hand, when we get back and attend the TV, we see the same things, wars, violence, power, disempowered people, the same things. You say the world will never change, and everything is changing. This has become nowadays, also because of the media, a big, big issue, which creates a big problem for each one of us and for the society as a whole. And the universities have to deal with that. When we deal with that, we need change. But what change means sometimes means even stand still, or even going in inverted commas to restore things. So what we have as a reply to the anxiety of change is from conservation to total reconstruction. Within this is evolution and revolution, as we discussed this. But it's adaptation, it's complementation, it's reconciliation, it's stabilization of roots, it's innovation. So we have to understand that all these are integral elements. And for example, just one, last night we discussed with colleagues about one of the new tyrannies we have to deal with. This is the dominance of vision, of picture. All our students write less good theses and essays because they are not used to write. They have pictures, and this has restricted both their imagination but also their ability for abstract thinking. So when we are talking about sustainability of the environment, we need also to have sustainability of the human mind, our students themselves. And this is very important. And of course, what we need out of that is higher education to ensure continuity, reference, balance. On the other hand, nothing is changing, as I said. Wars, victims, even sciences, governments, and administrations in their silos. So, higher education should open gates, as our colleague said this morning. In addition, and this is one of my last slides, Chairman, we need to deal with both complexity and uncertainty. And this means uncertainty, lack of, you know, threat and security, both from livelihoods to overall security global. So we need to deal, even if we teach disciplines, we need, and this is a way out, practical, for interdisciplinary, how to deal with specific issues like the mixes. Food security, energy security, water security, ecosystem security. So you approach it from the legal, you approach it from social, you approach it from technical, from all what I indicated before. And this is a practical way. We need to start with something tangible. So at the end, coming to the competences, the three vertical competences we identify in UNC to be transformative, to be a vision, I mean, to have a vision of change and holistic. But there is something else. Each one of educators should have the basic competence of leadership and the courage to be pragmatic in his analysis, sometimes pessimistic, but still inspiring and in an optimistic way conduct policies and teaching in an optimistic way to actually stimulate constructive position of the learners. So we are asking for one more competence, a combination of heart and guts.
Thank you.